The next speaker is Benjamin Pradou from CERN. He has been working as process control engineer for more than 10 years at CERN, where he worked on a control system for cooling, ventilation, and cryogenic. He is expert in process dynamic simulation. Since this year, he is in charge of the operation of the LHC cryogenics. He will present automatic PID performance monitoring applied to LHC cryogenics.
Thank you. Good morning. So my talk will be about automatic PID performance monitoring for LHC cryogenics. So this is about regulation loops and cryogenics, which are my two favorite topics. So after introduction, I will present you which regulation performance indicator we have chosen to estimate the performance of the loops and its application to LHC cryogenics. So CERN launched several data analytic techniques to help operation teams in the last years, and you have seen in the different days at conferences that several talks and posters were about this subject. One of these techniques has been applied to the LHC cryogenic system, which is one of the biggest control systems we have at CERN. So in terms of PID regulation loops, the cryogenics host about 5,000 loops. And it is then impossible to detect which loops are poorly tuned and which loops are well tuned. And this is important to know which loops are poorly tuned. Even if they are not triggering alarms or interlock, it can induce important effects. First, the too-fast controller can accentuate the aging of the actuators. Too-slow controllers generate oscillation, inducing mechanical or thermal issues on the process. And the poorly tuned PID can, of course, provoke, in case of large disturbance, interlocks and loss of availability for the LHC. So to estimate this performance, we have to choose an indicator, a number, in order to estimate if the loop is well tuned or not. Since the 80s, there are many researches in this field, and we have chosen to use a predictability index because it's applicable for any regulation loop, it's easy to compute, and it's just a few parameters to set up. So the idea to estimate this predictability index is that if it's equal to 1, it means the loop is fully predictable, and then you have the best achievable controller. And if this number is equal to 0, you have a poorly tuned regulation loop because it shows a kind of erratic behavior. So the idea is to be able to model the error of the PID loop doing a time series, and this AI coefficients can be found using a least square method. And then by doing the ratio between the residue variance and the mean square mean of the error, you have what we call this predictability index. So to parameterize this calculation, first you need to know you have to define a sampling time, then a time window over which you compute the predictability index, and from the time constant, you can estimate the prediction horizon and the regression model order, which you use to estimate the model error. And then, once you have this predictability index, of course, you have to set a threshold to define if your loop is well-tuned or not. In addition to this, we have added two other parameters. One is the standard deviation of the output of the controller, because we have many loops which are disabled, not working in regulation, or we have the loops which are saturating, and to not induce false positive, we have to discard these loops. Also, a loop can be poorly tuned for a time window, but not for others. So to consider a loop as poorly tuned, we have decided to consider n wrong windows time over 24 hours to assign this loop. So over the 5,000 available loops for LHC, we have applied this on 3,000 loops only, because in fact there are two other loops which are used only for unusual operation for LHC. So we use only the ones which are pertinent for the normal operation. And we split all these controllers in 5 big families, depending on the control task. Either it's a temperature control, pressure control, flow control, or level controls. And also we put apart this temperature control for superconducting magnets, because the time constant is very, very long, and the set of parameters are obviously different. So here you have the different parameters set up for these five big families. In terms of infrastructure to compute this, this index, we use a single virtual machine for the moment in the CERN Computing Center. So we retrieve the data from an Oracle database, where the LHC cryogenic data are stored. It's about 4 gigabytes of data per day. We extract and resample the data of the last day. Then we compute the predictability index, and we use a script written in R. And if we pass the threshold and satisfy the different condition, we consider the loop as poorly tuned, and we generate a PDF report, which is then published in a web server. So this script is executed every day. It takes about 6 hours to process all the loops. So when you arrive in the morning, you have the result of the previous day. And this solution can be scaled up using the Hadoop cluster at CERN, and can be parallelized with a Spark job. And this can be done in future, as we did for other data analytics. So now, if we see the result for 1 day of LHC, so we have chosen the 31st of July, which is kind of a normal day for LHC. So these are the beam 1 and beam 2 of LHC, and this is the beam energy. So at midnight, the beams were colliding, providing collisions. Then at 10 a.m., there was a beam dump. The beam was put again at 3 p.m. Then there was a dump, maybe because of a problem. Then it was re-injected again, and here you have the corresponding beam energy during this day. So it's really a typical day for LHC. And during this day, these 24 hours, these algorithms identify 140 poorly tuned loops. But they are not necessarily all poorly tuned, all of them. So the blue ones, so you have the five big families. The blue ones are really the ones which are poorly tuned. Then the red ones are the ones where it detects the loop as poorly tuned because there is a process issue, like something going wrong on the process, but it's not due to the regulation. And also, we can have some noise on some pressure controllers inducing a detection of a wrong regulation. And also, we have few false positives that happens in several cases. So we did the same repartition by per cryogenic system to be able to locate where this loop are coming from and to make some statistics. And here we have a big bar, which is about 40 PID loops, which are badly tuned in the level controllers for the distribution system. This was not a surprise because we knew that already, but it's confirming what we knew. So I will then show you three examples. One poorly tuned level control in the distribution system, so in this big category. An example of poor temperature control, and also a false positive for level control in the cryogenic refrigerator. So before showing you a poor tuning loop, let's see a good one. So this is a LHC tunnel with what we call DFB, distribution feedbox. These boxes are allowing the superconducting magnets to be powered. And they are filled with liquid helium inside, and we have to maintain a certain level of liquid helium. And the range of operation is very narrow. So this regulation has to be very precise. And here, in red, you have the set point. In green, this is the measured value that you try to control. And in blue, it's the actuator, which is the valve filling the liquid helium in the box. And in this case, the loop is well tuned. You have the predictability index for each time window over the 24 hour, which is about 0.8. You are above the threshold, everything is fine. And this is a standard deviation of the actuator, which is above the threshold, meaning that the regulation loop is working. Now, if we take another box, somewhere in is the machine, because all of them are different, then we can have this kind of behavior. So same set point, but here, impossible to have a constant and a well regulation. It's always oscillating, inducing maybe troubles. And the predictability index is about equal to zero. Okay, so it means that the loop is poorly tuned, whereas the actuator is moving. So this is an example, and we have many of this kind of poorly tuned loops. Unfortunately, we cannot tune them during the relay operation, so we have to wait for Christmas time, where we will try to adjust all these loops identified by this algorithm. Another example, which is important for HE, it's the inner triplets. So these magnets are the quadruples making the focusing of the beam before the collisions. And so they are maintained at 1.9 Kelvin, but they have also a thermal shielding at 70 Kelvin. And this thermal shield has to be controlled. And if the temperature is moving too much, it can induce mechanical movement of the magnets. And then you can have a misalignment of the beams for the collision. So it's a big issue for experiments. And here we have the set point, which is 63 Kelvin, and the temperature starts to oscillate. And there was about 4 Kelvin of oscillation. It's not yet critical, but it can be an issue in future. And because the predictability index was about 0.2, which is poorly tuned loop, so now this loop has been retuned since this time, and now it's showing a nice behavior. And as last example, an example in the refrigerator. So this is a cryogenic refrigerator. And inside this fridge, we have a big tank of liquid helium where we want to control the level. We just need to have a certain level, above a certain level, but we don't need a precise regulation. But if you look here, until 8:30 a.m., this was the set point and the regulation value, and it was very nice. The actuator was moving a lot, but the predictability index is fine. The problem is that this is an electrical heater making this control, and this kind of oscillation is not good for the actuator. So at 8:30, the operator decided to change the PID parameters. And of course, then you see the behavior of the loop, which is clearly completely different, and the predictability index fall down. So this case was okay for the PID performance, but not okay for operation. Whereas here, it was okay for process operation because we don't need an accurate control. We just need a smooth control, in fact, but it's not okay for the PID performance. So it's a case of false positives that we have to take into consideration for features. So as conclusion, we developed a proof of concept to validate this PID performance monitoring algorithm. And now the next step is really to push this in production, because now it's still a proof of concept in a small web server somewhere, and we really would like to use that in operation team. And of course, this solution can be scaled up using the same computing capabilities. The algorithm can be improved, as we have seen in this last example, where we should maybe, for dedicated loop, take different control objectives into account. And also, we can imagine to insert some penalties in the actuator movement in order to take this inside the algorithm. Thank you.
Thank you, Benjamin. Is there some questions? Yes, here.
So, do you have any...
Microphone, please.
Do you have any way of automating the computation for the time constants for the loops, you know, some kind of system, automatic system identification?
The time constant of the loop are obviously different, and we did these five big families, and maybe they are not completely adequate. So maybe we can decide afterward to have kind of identification, online identification, to identify more carefully this time constant and to put this back in the algorithm. It's an idea, but yeah, we haven't thought about that. But it can be a good idea. Yeah. Thank you.
Other questions? Yeah.
You know, cryogenic system is a very slow system. I want to know how to deal with the delay time problem.
So, as you said, cryogenics is very slow. When you look at the time constant I showed in this table, it's about minutes or even hours. So it means that the time constant of the system is 2 hours at least. And the time delay, it can be minutes. Okay, so when you start to move something, you see the effect several minutes or 10 minutes after. So it's a very, very slow system. And that's why, as well, the PIDs are tuned in such a way that it cope with these associated delays.
No questions? Okay, I have one. So if I understand well, all these data are stored in the database by the WinCCOA.
Yes.
And so it means that all the 3,000 loops are, each parameter is archived. At which speed it is archived?
So it's the archiving process of the data. It's kind of event-based. It's not a polling with a fixed sampling time. So basically, what happens is that we can define a minimum time to archive the data, but then if it passes a dead band, we archive immediately the data. So there are different techniques which are applied depending on the sensor or the loop considered. But basically, the resolution for a temperature controller, for instance, for the superconducting magnets, it's archived at the 5 millikelvin precision.
Okay.
So it's quite, that's why we generate about 4 gigabytes of data per day, which is quite large.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you again. For